Welcome to everybody. Thank you for joining us for this CBRL webinar. My name is Carol Palmer, and I'm the CBRL director in Amman, Jordan, where I'm joining you from today, and where in the last week it's turned very wintry. So the seasons have moved on. So, Council for British Research in the Levant, for those of you who may not be familiar with our organisation, we're an independent research charity and membership organisation based in the UK with institutes in the region, one in Amman and one in East Jerusalem. And we're founded to conduct research and disseminate information and knowledge on the Levant or the Levantine Middle East. We're actually part of the British Academy's 7 British international research institutes. And via the British Academy, we receive a grant in aid to help us continue our operations. But we're always grateful to our members and friends who support us in various ways to do additional events and additional projects. In normal times, we would be doing events in person, of course, as well, but we have moved online with the current situation. And we're very happy that despite being a very difficult situation, it's allowed us to connect across continents. And indeed, today, our speakers are speaking from North America, from London, from Germany, and from the region, from the Levant. I'm in Jordan myself. We hope that you enjoy today's webinar and that you will join us for future events too. Do take a look at our website for more information about CBRL if you're new to us, and please do sign up to our mailing list if you're not already receiving notices about these events through our regular emails. I'm just going to, before introducing our chair today, I'm going to just give a few house rules and what to expect today, how we run our CBRL webinars. First of all, I'll hand over to our chair, Marina Rusto, and then she will introduce our speaker and author of A Commerce of Knowledge, Dr. Simon Mills. He'll speak for around 20 minutes or so, and then we'll have a conversation between the chair and Simon for about another 20 minutes. And then we invite you, or even during the talks, we invite you to put your questions that you would like to ask of our speaker and chair in the Q&A, please. Put them as they occur to you throughout the talk, but we'll come later on to ask your questions. Please keep your questions short, generally one question per person, and when we're asking the questions, we'll read them out from the Q&A, including your name, unless you specifically indicate that you don't wish to be named. So I'm going to now introduce our chair. Professor Marina Rusto is the Hidori A. Zilcha Professor of Near Eastern Studies and Professor of History at Princeton University, Director of the Princeton Janitsa Lab and Director of the Near Eastern Studies Program there. She's the author of Heresy and the Politics of Community, The Jews of the Fatimid Caliphate, published in 2008, and of the Lost Archive, Finding a Caliphate in a Cairo Synagogue, 2020, most recently. We'd like to thank her very much for agreeing to be chair today. It's wonderful to have you with us, and we're very much looking forward to this presentation and conversation on this book. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Carol, for the introduction and also for the invitation to chair this event. This book is very close to my heart. Although Simon and I had never met before we started corresponding about this particular event, but we know some of the same characters. So I'm really happy to be here. It's a pleasure to introduce Dr. Simon Mills, who is lecturer in early modern history at Newcastle University, where he's been since 2019. And where he teaches the history of science, the history of ideas, and also the relationships between early modern Europe and the Ottoman Empire. Simon has held a number of prestigious fellowships at the Center for Research in the Arts, Social Sciences, and Humanities, known affectionately as CRASH, its acronym, at the University of Cambridge, at the Dahlem Humanities Center at the Free University in Berlin, and he's also been a Leverhulme Early Career Fellowship at the University of Kent, between 2014 and 2017. He was also a British Institute scholar here at the Council for British Research in the Levant in Amman, while he also undertook or pursued his Arabic studies at the Qasid Institute. His book, which we're gonna be talking about today, is called A Commerce of Knowledge, Trade, Religion, and Scholarship Between England and the Ottoman Empire, circa 1600 to 1760. It was published in January of 2020. A very early review, I don't even know if you've seen this yet, Simon, has praised it as reconstructing a deeply human world in which scholars from different religious traditions came together to exchange ideas, which in 2020 sounds less like a sort of weak palliative and more like a distant utopia. So with that, I leave it to you, Simon.
Thank you. Okay, well, hopefully you can see the first slide there, yeah. So I begin with a photograph of the Khan el-Jumruk, customs khan, in the old city of Aleppo in Syria, which I took in the winter of 2010. And I begin in this way partly because it gives me a chance to say thank you to Carol and to the CBRL. I was in Syria during my year as a British Institute scholar in Amman, which is where I was able to begin work on what would eventually become a commerce of knowledge. So it's really a pleasure to be able to speak for this series about the book. I mentioned the date somewhat hesitantly because it reveals how long it took me to see the project through to completion. And I'm not really sure that anybody would judge that a single book for your library 10 years later was very much by way of return for awarding me the scholarship. But nevertheless, I'm very glad that you did. So the Khan el-Jumruk was built in 1574 under the Ottomans as a commercial building to serve Aleppo's then expanding role in the silk trade. And by the 17th century, it was being used by the small European communities, Venetian and French merchants who'd been drawn to Syria by that trade. And the reason I went to see this building in particular is because certainly by the second half of the 17th century, it was home to the 50 or so English merchants then living and working in Aleppo. And what was fascinating to learn in 2010 was not only that the building was still being used for purposes very similar to those for which it had been built in the 16th century, but also that the men working there with whom I talked were well aware of the history of the building's former use by European merchants. Well, I ask you perhaps to hold that image of the Khan el-Jumruk in Syria in mind, as I turn to what might seem the very different topic of the quotation with which I began the book, A Commerce of Knowledge. The author is a 17th century theologian and Hebrew scholar called John Lightfoot, writing from the wonderfully named parish of Muchmundon in Hertfordshire. And he's addressing an Oxford scholar called Edward Bernard, who had recently succeeded Sir Christopher Wren as a civilian professor of astronomy at Oxford, and who had a very wide range of interests, including the then fashionable study of what were called at the time the Oriental languages, a broad category, including Hebrew and Arabic and Syriac, but also languages such as Persian. And they're talking about a third Englishman, a man called Robert Huntington, who had recently sent Bernard an account of his activities in Syria. And Lightfoot, after expressing his approval of everything Bernard had told him about Huntington's travels, says in the second part of the quotation here, "But I could half find it in my heart to envy him for this, for that he hath the ocular view of those places in the land of Canaan that I have been blundering to find out, till I have been ready to lose myself as I have sitten here. And this image of a 17th century Hebrew scholar lamenting his having missed the chance he might have had to see Palestine for himself led me to a question, which was, what was the relationship, if indeed there was one, between, on the one hand, Lightfoot's world of biblical and Oriental scholarship, which I'd first come to as a student of the history of ideas, and secondly, the contemporary beginnings of English trade in the Ottoman Empire and the presence of those English merchants in the Khan al-Jumruk. And my key to answering this question was to look to the chaplains sent out in the last years of the 16th century to minister to the English merchants. I've just mentioned one of them, Robert Huntington, but here's probably the most well-known, Edward Pocock. Pocock traveled to Aleppo as a young man in 1630, and he spent 6 years in the city as chaplain to the English merchants and consul. He used his years in Syria to learn Arabic and to piece together a very substantial collection of Arabic and Hebrew manuscripts, which would eventually come into the Bodleian Library in Oxford. Pocock was appointed in 1636 by the then Archbishop of Canterbury, William Lord, as the first professor of Arabic at Oxford, a chair which still exists today. He later returned to the Ottoman Empire as chaplain to the English ambassador in Istanbul, where he continued his studies and his collecting. And he went on in the course of a long life to become not only one of the leading European scholars of Arabic in the 17th century, but also a very important Hebraist, and particularly a pioneer in the field of Judeo-Arabic, that is, Arabic written in Hebrew script used by the Arabic-speaking Jews of the medieval Middle East. So Pocock and some of the other chaplains, through their biographies and through their careers, encapsulated for me themes with which I was concerned in the book, trade, religion, and scholarship. Well, although I begin in England, most of the action of the book plays out in Aleppo. And one of the questions I wanted to investigate was, what level of interaction did Pocock, Huntington, and other chaplains have with the Jewish, Christian, and Muslim residents of Ottoman Syria? Most histories which I'd read to date of the Ottoman Empire tended to depict the English merchants as living in isolation from the local population, but I wanted to interrogate whether that was really the case. So I went back to the records from Aleppo in the National Archives in Kew, and I began to find documents like this. It's a note to payment to two men serving as what were called mallims, from the Arabic mu'allim, whose job was to oversee the transport of goods between Aleppo and the port at Iskenderun. And you can probably see on the slide here that they've entered their own Arabic signatures in the minute book in the English consul. The one on the left interested me particularly because, as you might be able to see, the man's name is Haj Ahmed, or Hamid, in the first line of the English text. It's an 18th century biography of Pocock in which the author gives some account of Pocock's time in Aleppo, and he happens to mention that Pocock employed a servant named Hamid to improve his spoken Arabic. So looking at this document in the National Archives, I realized that it wasn't impossible I'd found here the signature of the man who helped Pocock to learn Arabic. Well, that's of course a bit speculative. There was no doubt more than one person called Ahmed in 17th century Aleppo, but it is possible to connect Pocock to another Ahmed, a man called Ahmed al-Gulshani, who largely from colophons, such as this one in a manuscript now in Pocock's collection, was able to identify as a Sufi and a member of the Gulshaniya Lodge mentioned in some of the biographical dictionaries from 17th century Aleppo. Ahmed al-Gulshani acquired on Pocock's behalf a very large number of the books which Pocock was able to buy in Aleppo. Among them, works on poetry, literary criticism, lexicography, geography, history, medicine, algebra, astronomy, philosophy, and religion. All of this material would be essential to Pocock's later career as a scholar of Arabic. Ahmed al-Gulshani also not only bought manuscripts on Pocock's behalf, but tutored him in Arabic. We know from the report of a rival collector in Aleppo that over the course of a year, Ahmed al-Gulshani and Pocock worked together through a manuscript of the Proverbs, or Amthal, of the philologist al-Maidani, a translation of which from Arabic Pocock made during his time abroad. It's important perhaps to stress here that Aleppo was by no means only an Islamic city in the 17th century. And many of the chaplain's most important scholarly connections were with the Jews and Christians of Ottoman Syria. Another part of the book explores Robert Huntington's collaboration with this man, a Samaritan called Marheb ben Jacob, or Mufarraj ibn Yaqub in Arabic, as he has signed his name here in a reader's note in one of the manuscripts bought in Nablus by Robert Huntington, a historical chronicle by the Samaritan author Abul Fatah. The Samaritans were particularly of interest to Huntington and European scholars of his generation, owing in large part to the belief that the Samaritan script was an older form of Hebrew than the more familiar so-called square script. And Huntington went to great lengths to persuade Marheb ben Jacob and the Samaritans to send a copy of their Pentateuch, the first five books of the Old Testament, to England. And sad to say, Pocock was not wholly honest in his dealings with Marheb ben Jacob. Huntington was also in contact with other Jewish booksellers in Aleppo and Damascus and was able to acquire through them an important collection of biblical and post-biblical literature. Among his most extraordinary finds were parts of the Mishneh Torah by probably the greatest medieval Jewish scholar Maimonides, containing, amazingly, Maimonides' own signature, and a part of Maimonides' working copy of his commentary on the Mishnah. Extraordinarily, the same manuscript which Pocock had found in Aleppo probably 40 years earlier. Huntington was also the most important collector of Eastern Christian manuscripts. And so another part of my book reconstructs Huntington's relationship with the then Maronite Patriarch of Antioch, Estefana Dewehi, upon whom Huntington drew to locate books in Syriac and Arabic from the Lebanese monasteries in Mount Lebanon. The image which you see here is a copy, Huntington's copy of Amasai al-Fatib, Questions on Medicine by Hanain ibn Ishaq, which Huntington acquired from Lebanon, and which contains marginal notes which might well, at least Huntington thought, be in the hand of Estefana Dewehi himself. In his collecting among the Christians in Syria, Huntington was particularly interested in the works of early Christian authors whose writings might have survived in Syriac versions. Huntington was perhaps the most adventurous of all the chaplains who served in Aleppo, and in search of books, he traveled not only throughout Syria, but also to Jerusalem, to Cyprus, and to Egypt. So in covering in this way the English chaplains' dependence on the collaborators whom they encountered in Ottoman Syria raised for me a series of further questions. First, I was led to ask to what extent men such as Ahmed al-Ghazali determined the interests of collectors like Pocock and Huntington. And what I found here was actually that the English chaplains came to Syria with a pretty firm idea of what they wanted to achieve. Their priorities in general were set by the concerns of European scholarship, and the whole question of developments within that scholarship across both Catholic and Protestant Europe was one of the issues I tried to explore in the book. However, within the boundaries determined by those pre-existing interests, the particular works and the particular copies of those works acquired by the chaplains were very often a result of the decisions of their Ottoman interlocutors. This then raised a further question, which is, to what extent were the collections brought home by Pocock, Huntington, and other chaplains reflective of local scholarly cultures in the Ottoman Empire? And the answer to that question is one of the things I tried to tease out throughout the course of the book. Okay, well, that's a very small sample. And in the interests of trying to keep to time, I'll do no more now than say in passing that I also try to think about the topic of the chaplain's interests in antiquities, what we might now call the material culture of Syria. Among other schemes, I tell the story of two early expeditions to the ruins of Palmyra, which you see depicted here in a 17th century account inspired by those expeditions. The first, alas, met with little success. The explorers were robbed and were forced to retreat hastily to Aleppo. The second, undertaken by a group of English merchants and a chaplain called William Halifax, fared somewhat better in that Halifax was able to bring back from the site, albeit rather crude, copies of inscriptions in Palmyrene, an Aramaic dialect which was then undeciphered by Europeans. And again here, I try to emphasize how this was less a straightforward case of European discovery, but rather that any knowledge acquired in Syria was dependent in different ways on the know-how and the traditions, both of the local Ottoman population and of the long established presence of Roman Catholic clerics across the Levant. In the final part of the book, I deal with the chaplain's early attempts to launch an English mission in Syria and the production of printed Arabic Bibles in close collaboration with the Greek Orthodox Church in Aleppo, and in particular with the 18th century Greek Orthodox Patriarch of Antioch, a man called Athanasius Stabas. And I explore, among other things, the production of the work which you see here on the right, printed book of Arabic Psalms produced in London in 1725, and the way in which its production was very closely bound up with the book on the right, the same work printed in Aleppo in 1706, often identified as the first Arabic book printed in the Ottoman Empire. So in conclusion then, I want to return to the question with which I began, that is the nature of the relationship between trade and scholarship. Why, you might ask, pose this question in the first place? Well, one of the things that led me in this direction was reading what I thought was a very thoughtful review article by the historian Francesca Trivolato. She was thinking largely of recent work, not on England, but on Italy and Italian connections to the Muslim Mediterranean. And she finished her review by asking how we might conceptualize the relationship between culture and economics. What do European exchanges with the Ottoman Empire, documented by scholars working in art, architectural, or intellectual history, tell us about this relationship? The answer which I developed through my study of the English chaplains is, I think, twofold, one relating to a micro and one to a macro level. First, perhaps I should say what I think the book does not argue, which is that there was no straightforwardly deterministic relationship between the expansion of English trade in the Ottoman Empire and the concomitant development of Oriental studies in England. The collecting and investigation of the chaplains actually did very little to serve the political or commercial interests of the English Levant Company or the English state. On a micro level, I suggest throughout the book that we need to look to particulars. It really mattered for English scholarship that the English established connections in Aleppo and in Istanbul, rather than, say, in Cairo or in Baghdad, because these connections were their way into local scholarly cultures and made it possible for them to pursue certain antiquarian or missionary schemes. Pocock and Huntington were really able to buy the manuscripts they did because of those relationships which they formed with Ahmed Oghelshani, Maher Ben Yaqub, Istefana Dewehi, Athanasius Dabas, and others. And those manuscripts then, to a large extent, determined the course of scholarly projects in 17th and 18th century England, and indeed further afield. On the macro level, I argue that there was a connection between, on the one hand, the movement from the mid-18th century onwards away from the kind of biblically centered Oriental studies at the heart of my book to new interests in Persian and the languages of East Asia. And on the other hand, a shift in English commercial interests away from Syria to India. Again, this is not because scholars pursued projects which might be useful to commercial or political agendas, but rather because new lines of communication opened up between England and the Persian Gulf, brought with them opportunities to collect manuscripts and information, a development which I trace in the final section of the book through the figure of the Oxford Orientalist Thomas Hyde. But the final thing I'll say, and the point which perhaps I would like to stress most of all, is this: that telling the history of European Oriental studies from not from Oxford or Rome or Paris or Leiden, but as seen from Aleppo, brings into much sharper focus the role of Ottoman subjects as scholars, tutors, informers, copyists, brokers, and dealers, and indeed as mediators between local learned cultures and Western Europe. And this is important, I think, because both the older Saidian model of Orientalism, but also to a large extent, the much more nuanced and specialized histories of Western Oriental studies have tended to understand this scholarship as a predominantly European phenomenon. What I've tried to argue here is that when we move back a stage and look at the initial acquisition of manuscripts and the skills required to interpret them, we can begin to reconceptualize the history of European Oriental studies as a process of transmission between Ottoman and European scholarly cultures, or to use the language of the book, as commerce between East and West. And thank you very much for listening.
Thank you so much, Simon. That was an amazingly comprehensive yet brief introduction to the book, which I'm sure our listeners appreciated, whether or not they've actually read the book already. And it actually you kind of ended exactly where I want to begin. So I come to this book from far outside the early modern period. I'm a medievalist and I deal with Arabic and Judeo-Arabic manuscripts. And so for me, I got really excited about your book and found it to be a breakthrough in a couple of ways. First of all, the goal of my field of study, so medieval Arabic and Judeo-Arabic, for the last 200 years has been, for example, like if you're dealing with an 11th century work, to basically erase everything after the 11th century in the interest of avoiding anachronism. And one of the things that you want to try and erase is the mistakes that were made by scribes in copying the work throughout the centuries. And you want to get back to the urtext, right? This is the goal of philology, is let's get back to the purest, most original form of the text that we can, the book as the author composed it. But in fact, this is a bit of a sort of artificial way of proceeding, because learning was never just book learning anywhere, but it especially wasn't just book learning in the Islamic world, where learning was always situated in a chain of transmission of masters and disciples. So in a sense, the later history of these works and how they were transmitted in a very specific social context is a part of their history. And that's an awareness that I think has finally come to manuscript studies in general and Middle Eastern manuscript studies in specific, especially in the last decade or so. There's really this kind of awareness of we have to read the marginalia, we have to read the ownership notes and understand the full history of the manuscript as an object. But also, even where scholars of Middle Eastern manuscripts have concerned themselves with how libraries acquired the manuscripts that they did and when they did so, whether it was in the 17th century or in the case of many of the North American collections in the 19th century, European and North American scholars have focused on the European collectors, while just assuming that it was impossible to know anything about their sources and contacts in the Middle East itself. So your book demonstrates that not only can we know where they collected and with whose help, we can also understand just how dependent these scholars and manuscript collectors were on the generosity and the erudition of specific individuals whom we can name and whose intellectual horizons and cultural world we can reconstruct. So you say somewhere in the book, it is possible that on occasion Europeans participated directly in auctions at Aleppo, because book auctions were the main place where books were acquired. However, they more likely depended on intermediaries to purchase the books for them. In fact, one of the most interesting aspects of European collectors, you say, is their reliance on local scholars. Native Arabic speakers in cities such as Aleppo could serve both as practical guides into the labyrinths of local book markets and as intellectual mentors, inducting Europeans into the traditions of Arabic Islamic scholarship. So sort of moving beyond this purely transactional relationship to the text and talking about an actual relationship of intellectual transmission. So that brings me to my first question, which is, when did you first realize that you could write a book not just about the English chaplains to the Blount Company, not just about Pocock and Huntington and the others, but also about their local contacts? In other words, that you could write a connected intellectual history of the Ottoman Empire and English commerce and learning. I think, you know, often we have to explain to our doctoral students, it's not enough to have a good question. Your question also has to be answerable from the sources. So at what point did you realize that this project was actually viable?
Well, that's a very good question. I think if I'm very honest, I would say it wasn't entirely clear to me that it was viable until I'd finished the book, in the sense that through the course of researching and writing it, the whole question of the kind of intellectual or scholarly environment in which English collectors were working was something I had to very slowly piece together and try to work out. And I mean, my starting point for the book was always really European sources, and probably I would say most of all letters. So I think the point of departure was really the letters which putting together all the letters which I could find, which chaplains wrote home from Aleppo, and reading them. And then one finds occasional mentions of the figures with whom they're interacting and dealing with, and so it was really a case of working outwards from those to try and begin to reconstruct the world in which they were working. I could say more about the sources, but I don't know if you want to. You had other.
Yeah, I mean, I'm interested in the pragmatics of this as well. I mean, how did you think to look for certain sources? You know, where did you suspect you might find something? Were there smoking guns where suddenly you saw the project differently from how you'd seen it before?
Yeah, well, I mean, one of the first ways into it was the figure whom I mentioned, Ahmed al-Ghushani, and that really came from work which had been done before I wrote the book, partly by the Arab scholar of Islamic history, Peter Malcolm Holt, who first discovered these letters in the Bodleian Library, and then in Gerald Toomer's book on the history of Arabic studies. And so I went and looked at those letters in the Bodleian when I was first beginning this project, and I suppose started to think, who was this character? How would Pocock have come into contact with him? How did he manage to find these books? And from there, there were two other ways which I tried to find back into his world. The first was the colophons to some of the manuscripts which he collected from Pocock. And as you'll know very well, one sometimes finds reading colophons very interesting snippets of information. So he'll refer to himself as al-Halabi. So you can assume, you know, that he's from Aleppo. And in one of them, he says, he refers to himself as al-Ghushani Tariq, or Tariqatan. So he mentions that he's affiliated with this Sufi order in Aleppo. So that was another thing. And then I also looked to the biographical dictionaries of 17th century Aleppo to see if I could find out anything about this world. And I would say that the insights really were few and far between. It took quite a long time to try to reconstruct this environment. And then, of course, that was set against my own developing reading in the field of early in the work of Middle Eastern historians and various things that people had done in that on that topic as well. So it built up very slowly. Yeah.
It is often true that we don't know whether our project is viable until after we finish it. So I'm very sympathetic to that. A couple of just housekeeping notes before I ask you a follow-up to that, which is, first of all, at least one listener has said that the volume is low, Simon. So if you could just speak closer to your microphone, yeah, that would be helpful. And then also, I just want to issue a reminder, some of you have started to do this already, to formulate your questions and put them into the chat, even as we're speaking, because it's always better to get those questions out there while they're fresh. And we'll turn to you at the end of our discussion. So were there sources that you looked for but couldn't find? Were there roadblocks where you thought, wow, I really want to go in this direction, but I can't because I can't find the evidence?
I would say that one of them was one thing I really wanted to do in the book, and it was in some ways it was an extraordinarily difficult task, but I thought it was important, was to try to say at least something about the whole breadth of the cultural and religious diversity that Pocock and Huntington, et cetera, would have encountered in Aleppo. It would have been, in some respects, easier for me to focus the whole of that section on Pocock and Ahmed al-Ghushani and to talk mainly about Pocock's collection of Arabic materials. But that would have, in some senses, misrepresented what he and Huntington were doing, in that they had these extraordinarily eclectic interests which encompass both Jewish and Christian literature. But I would say that probably the question of the Jewish culture in Aleppo was the hardest thing for me to reconstruct. And that was partly, of course, because of my own lack of skills to do it, but also because I think on one sense that I'm not sure if it's a consequence of the kinds of prejudices that Europeans have, but they tend to say much less about the Jewish intellectual life, and the things that one gets in Pocock's biography, for example, tend to be quite dismissive of that culture. And then also, I think it's just chance that there are several points where Huntington talks in some of his letters about Jewish intermediaries from whom he's bought manuscripts, and this may be the point where he's acquiring the Maimonides manuscripts, which are so famous. But he's frustratingly reticent about saying anything about these people from whom he's buying manuscripts. So there are quite large lacunae, and I would say that those pertain particularly to the kind of Jewish intellectual world that the chaplains encountered in Aleppo. Yeah. I mean, you go ahead. Yeah.
So yeah, no, I mean, hopefully others will follow up on some of those leads that you kind of left dangling. A book can't do everything after all. But I wanted to ask you, I mean, that actually leads nicely into the next question I wanted to ask about, which is why Aleppo? So the first part of your book centers more on Aleppo than the second. In the second half, there's more kind of traveling around, going in search of curiosities, especially Huntington, because he traveled quite a bit more than Pocock around Syria and Palestine and made it as far as Basra in Iraq. But you really get the sense of local context in Aleppo. You know how close the Khan al-Jumruk was, you know, to the Teke, to the Sufi lodge where al-Gushani was a member. I mean, you had this kind of, you know, micro-historical picture of Aleppo. Could you have done the same kind of micro-historical study for other places, say for Constantinople or Alexandria or Smyrna, the other places where there were Levant Company outposts, or even somewhere in Morocco or some of the Venetian colonies? And if you could have done so, would you have wanted to? Or was Aleppo really the story that you wanted to tell?
Yeah, that's a very good question. I mean, I think certainly, and I thought about this for a long time when writing the book, I could have done it for Aleppo, Istanbul, Constantinople, and Smyrna, Izmir. Probably less so for the last, because I don't think that, certainly from the perspective of the Europeans who were there, Smyrna, Izmir was quite such an important center for learning, particularly for manuscript collecting. Although there would have been very interesting things that could be said about the later parts of the book, i.e. the exploration of antiquities and material culture from Smyrna. So I think it could have been a book about Aleppo as it was, but it could also have been a book about Constantinople, Istanbul. And I think one of the reasons I didn't do that was because it would have made it a slightly or a very different book. Firstly, because there were things in Constantinople which chaplains couldn't do in Aleppo, and one of those was collecting Greek manuscripts. So obviously the book makes this connection between English trade and the Ottoman Empire and this particular branch of scholarship in terms of what we're calling Oriental studies. But that wasn't the whole story, and many of the chaplains who ended up going to Constantinople were particularly interested more than anything perhaps in collecting Greek manuscripts, and that wasn't particularly the story I wanted to tell. I wanted to talk about this encounter between the kind of world that they found themselves in Aleppo. And then I think part of your question really gives the answer to why I chose to focus on a single city, which was I really wanted to write a kind of history of ideas and a history of exchange, which really tried as much as I could to drill down into particulars, to think about exactly how did Pocock and Huntington acquire these manuscripts, who were the characters whom they met, and what sort of relationships did they have, how would they have come into contact with each other, where would they have met one another. And it seemed to me that those sorts of questions could be best answered by a kind of microhistory which made the city of Aleppo itself almost one of its characters, and tried to think about the space of Aleppo. And so I devoted quite a lot of the first part of the book to thinking about where the chaplains lived, what kinds of interactions they might possibly have had there, what other sorts of intellectual and cultural life were happening in Aleppo, and to what extent would the chaplains have been able to gain any insight or access to this. So the whole thing, I think from quite early on, seemed to work as a sort of micro history, as you say, of a single city, and Aleppo seemed to be the place where I could get into the book as much of the intellectual material as possible. So that was really the decision to do Aleppo.
So it's interesting, the title of the book, A Commerce of Knowledge, is kind of it's taken from one of your sources, but it's also a play on this idea that that commerce for the people you discuss in your book was not just about, you know, the trade in silk and other commodities, but also about interchange, about intellectual interchange. And there's also another kind of nice quotation that you use as a chapter title, which is Turkey Labors, from one of the English chaplains in the 1680s, John Guise, who refers to the fruits of my Turkey labors. So we know that Turkey is often used as a kind of shorthand for the entire Ottoman world, although it was much more than just Turkish. But tell us about labor as a concept underpinning the book. And I'll just say what I mean by the question. You quote a really interesting passing suggestion of the early modern historian of science, Lorraine Daston, that this distinctive brand, she says, of early modern European curiosity about the unfamiliar was not just intellectual interest, but also in a sense, a kind of hunger or even greed or consumerism, the dynamics of which, she says, mirrored those of the trade in luxuries. But your book in some ways actually contests this claim. You say that Europeans really weren't in a position to consume anything without local help. And I think for me, the moment when the penny dropped was you compared your 17th century collectors with the 19th century collectors with whom I'm more familiar because I work primarily on a collection that was gathered together in, or dispersed, I should say, in the late 19th century. You say the early modern collector was a much tamer beast than his successor, the antiquarian imperialist of the 19th century. The examples you offer are Curzon and Tischendorf, both of whom divested various monasteries in the Ottoman Empire in Egypt of some of their oldest biblical manuscripts. And you say that these 19th century imperialists had the money to buy at any cost and the audacity, when buying was not an option, to steal. But is there also not a kind of balance of power, right? The Ottomans had the upper hand militarily in the 17th century, whereas the Europeans did in the 19th century. So the Europeans really weren't in a position to steal in the 17th century in a way that they would have been in the 19th and to get away with it. So can you talk about both the labor aspects of this and the power aspects of it?
Yeah, that's it. Well, maybe I'll start with the second part, the power aspects. And what you said is absolutely right. And I think one of the topics I started reading about when beginning the book was to think about the way that economic historians had written recently about European trade in the Ottoman Empire. And the impression I got was very much that there was an attempt to move beyond an idea of Europeans as the sort of the drivers and the kind of outward going force of the development of trade in the 16th and 17th century, and instead to try to think about the way that when French or English merchants turned up in Aleppo, they were and other places, they were entering a kind of commercial environment that was already well established before they got there, and they by necessity were forced to depend on local economic structures and local economic practices in order for their trade to be successful. And it seemed to me that was quite a good way of also thinking about the question of collecting, that it might be possible to get beyond perhaps what people's first thoughts would be of European collectors, where I think probably most of us would very much project back this idea of 19th century collectors, and instead try to think that Europeans were turning up in worlds of the intellectual commerce of the book markets and this kind of thing, which are already very well established before they got there. There's one section in the book where and this was the only bit of explicit evidence that I found stating this, where one of the rival collector to Pocock mentions the fact of a Persian manuscript collector in Aleppo buying up a whole library. And so you really get this idea of Europeans as being in competition with other Ottoman, or in this case Persian collectors. And so that sense that Europeans weren't entirely driving everything, they had to carefully edge their way into something which was there which existed before they arrived there, was really something I wanted to try to get to grips with in talking about commerce in this intellectual and scholarly sense. In terms of labor, I suppose that one of the questions which I wanted to try to answer, which had never really, as far as I could tell, been even posed really in works which had been written about the chaplains and their experience before I began, was what were they doing there? What was their motivation? There's a straightforward answer to that, which was that they were paid by the Levant Company to minister to the English merchants and the consul. But the Levant Company expected not very much more of them than that. And that clearly wasn't the only reason why lots of them went there. So I began to think about what were their connections with the kinds of relationships with friends and scholars in Europe that they maintained, but also what were the kind of expectations on them of going to Aleppo. And my feeling was that, particularly in people like Huntington, whom I talked about, you can really see this sense in which there's a whole community of European scholars sort of depending on Huntington as their way into this world of Middle Eastern intellectual life, and also all of the possibilities for antiquarian explanation, which I talk about as well. And so it's this, the labor comes from this sense of expectation to a scholarly community. And that, of course, fits, you know, very well into the kinds of things that historians have been talking about for a long time, about the Republic of Letters and the kinds of social codes governing scholarly life in the early modern period. And so I suppose what I was trying to do was think about how that Republic of Letters and how those social codes might expand to an outpost like Aleppo.
So I'm going to bring in at this point a question from one of our attendees. Nagihan Halilolu asks an excellent question, which is, can you say a bit more about how denominational differences between Brits and Syrians in particular played out in acquiring or producing these manuscripts?
Mm. Well, maybe if I could just say something very briefly first, which is perhaps not quite related to the question, which is that there were also very important denominational differences between the various Europeans in Syria, in Aleppo. And that's one very important part of the book, which I haven't really talked about, which is the kind of competition that goes on between, say, English and French merchants or collectors. And that's, of course, denominational, because it's about the competing agendas of Protestants and Catholics in Europe, and the way that Oriental studies as a discipline is integral to those divisions. In terms of denominational differences between the English and the Syrians, I suppose that one part of the story which I wanted to tell was that there are these moments where in relationships like the one between Pocock and Ahmed al-Ghushani, where it's possible in a city like Aleppo, in a way that was perhaps unique to places like Aleppo, where it was possible for them to overlook to some extent confessional differences and to be united by the kinds of scholarly projects which they shared. So I mentioned very briefly in the presentation that Huntington treated less than honorably the Samaritans, and that's perhaps the one point in the book where one can see a certain sort of confessional difference, perhaps in the sense that the European scholars involved clearly thought that it or allow themselves to deceive the Samaritans because of the importance which they judged of acquiring a copy of the Pentateuch. And there I try to explain that perhaps by thinking about the way that these bonds of friendship, which is the term which Huntington himself uses, perhaps have limits when, as I said in the book, I think the stakes are so high in terms of the intellectual gains to be made.
So, and of course, there were also differences in denomination among Europeans, which are a part of the story that's kind of hovering in the background a bit. So what about those differences, say, between the Protestant Christians from Europe versus the Catholic Christians from Europe? Is there a parallel story to be told, and was there competition between those groups?
Yes. So, I mean, there's competition on the level of collecting. I mean, one very much gets a sense, particularly by the time you get to Huntington in the 1670s, that various European states, particularly England and France, are very much in competition, or the collectors in Aleppo are very much in competition from those different nations in terms of their attempts to collect manuscripts. And the French are, in some senses, much better equipped to do this, partly because of the initiative of Jean-Baptiste Colbert, Louis XIV's minister, who has a whole network of collectors sent out all across the Middle East, including Aleppo. And many of these people come onto Huntington's radar, and Huntington, as I say, is very much in competition with them. So there's a kind of acquisitiveness among Europeans, which very much puts them at odds with one another. But that's only one part of the story. And the other part I tell is that actually you tend to see, and again, particularly with Huntington, very good relationships between the English merchants and the English chaplains and the Roman Catholic clerics who are residents in across the Middle East. And this maybe comes to the fore more in the antiquarian section of the book than in the section on manuscripts, because I try to talk about the way in which the whole phenomenon of traveling to Jerusalem, it's very much a long established Catholic practice, and that when English merchants and English chaplains begin to do this, they're very much dependent on the Catholics, both for the kind of sort of straightforward infrastructural things, places to stay and possibilities to travel, but also for the kind of knowledge and traditions which have built up around the pilgrimage. And I try to point to various places where you can see these quite good relationships between the Europeans and the Roman Catholic merchants. So there's two sides to that story, really, I think, about European confessional differences.
So now turning to a different question that one of the audience members has asked, which, if you don't mind, I'll just briefly answer, which is how dominant, this is from Ikhlas al-Qananwe, how dominant was the usage of the Jewish Arabic script in the Levant compared to its usage in Egypt? And the answer is exactly the same, which is to say that especially rabbinic Jews wrote most of their Arabic writings using Hebrew script. It was Karaites and Samaritans who tended to use Arabic script more for writing Arabic, although not exclusively. And here there really aren't regional differences so much as there are, to come back to this, denominational differences. Now a question from Michael Ledger Lomas. Does the commerce model, which you posit for Aleppo and then extend to the Persian Gulf, work for other areas of early modern cultural contact, for example, North America, in relation to, you know, knowledge, if not perhaps to texts?
Yes, well, it's a very good question. And maybe I could sort of take a step back there and go back to the question which you asked originally, Marina, about the sort of origins for the book. And one of the things that I thought about a lot when I was sort of first coming up with the idea of it was reading in the history of science, and particularly the way that historians of science had done in a way which I thought that historians of scholarships had not really, had began to think about how science in Western Europe was very closely bound up with European expansion in other parts of the world, and particularly thinking about the kind of institutional nature of that expansion and the idea of trading companies and colonies, etc., and how and in what ways this was connected with development of science. And I suppose what I tried to do in a sense was to take some of that way of thinking about things and to apply it to a world which might have seemed at first a bit more resistant to it, this world of humanist scholarship and universities. So in that sense, I would say that there is a link between Aleppo and other parts of the world in terms of inquiry. But then of course, Aleppo and the Middle East generally is very particular to humanist scholarship because it has these links with manuscripts and intellectual cultures which were closely related to European interests. So I'm not sure that one could quite have done anything like the same thing in terms of the intellectual aspects of the book in another context. I mean, maybe further east, if you could certainly do something, perhaps a later story about the British in India and the way that was connected, and, you know, indeed many people have, but perhaps not with North America, although I might be wrong about that, but that's my feeling.
Now a question from Mela Leiklema from Utrecht University. The relationship between empire and religion has been much debated, especially for the 19th century. How to describe that relationship in the period that you've studied, given such efforts as, for example, the Boyle-Pocock-Grotius collaboration?
Yes, that's a very good question. I suppose in one way, I always thought as I was writing the book that it was important to me that I was telling a particular story which occurred before the end of the 18th century and before the Napoleonic invasion of Egypt. And it was a sort of, at least in my mind, a kind of pre-empire story in relation to the way that the British were, the English and then the British were operating in the Ottoman Empire. And that I think is very much reflected in the way that the Levant Company works. The Levant Company was very conservative in some ways and didn't really have a kind of expansionist philosophy in distinction to the English East India Company. And so I think that the sense that my chaplains weren't there as agents of empire, so to speak, is an important part of what they were doing. And it again goes back to that question we talked about earlier about the way that they're always having to edge their way into things which pre-exist them and which over which they don't necessarily have control. And so it's very much a story about what happens in encounters between different cultures in an age before empire, or at least when the English aren't the imperialists, because they're in certainly what through most of the story is a very an empire in terms of the Ottoman Empire. So I suppose in terms of the Pocock gracious collaboration, so maybe I'll just explain for other listeners that I think what the reference is to an attempt by Pocock to translate a book by Hugo Gracious into Arabic and to distribute it. I would see this as and I try to portray it in the book as something which is I wouldn't necessarily see as connected to the beginnings of an imperialist project. That's not to say that some of the people behind it, particularly Robert Boyle, might have thought of it to some extent in that way, but that's not really I think how Pocock would have thought of it, and I think rather different things are going on than a straightforward link between religion and imperialism. And it was in some sense to try to understand what those things were, which was one of the things I particularly wanted to do in the book.
So, and I suppose a follow-up question to that, also from Mela Leklema, is did the English chaplain's approach to proselytization engender any responses from local communities that we know of?
Yes, the answer is yes, and set out in more detail in the final part of the book. It follows on from the former part of the question about Pocock's translation of Hugo Gracious, and Pocock also translates parts of the English service into Arabic. And I go on in the book to talk about what I thought setting out was the much lesser known part of the story about what happens in the 18th century, which most of which relates to not actually to a chaplain, but to an English merchant called Roland Sherman, who gets very involved with the Greek Orthodox Church on a very local level in Aleppo. And this results in the production of the Bibles, which I showed in the last slide, Arabic Psalter and an Arabic New Testament, which the English then attempt to distribute mainly among Christians in Syria. So they do attempt to proselytize, but I think that it's a big topic, but maybe I'll just say two things. Firstly, that the whole, as I try to tell it, the whole of that story has to be understood against the much more sophisticated and in a way much more successful project of Roman Catholics to do the same thing in Syria, supported by a much more developed organization such as the Propaganda Fide, which don't exist at that point in the Protestant world. And the second thing I would say is that I'm not really sure that it's, as it may be later, a straightforward case of English people trying to convert anybody to Anglicanism. I try to see it much more as an attempt by people like Sherman, and not really quite so much on an institutional level, to defend what they see as the independent churches of the Middle East, the Greek Orthodox Church, against Roman Catholicism. So the whole question of Roman Catholic proselytization can't really be taken out of the story. Sorry, that's probably that maybe a rather complicated answer, but it's set out more coherently in the final part of the book.
I mean, it was a very rich answer, which is excellent. A question now from Gregor Schwab, who is an expert in Arabic and Judeo-Arabic manuscripts. Congratulations on your fascinating book, which I had the chance to read. To what extent did you come across European figures involved in the commerce of manuscripts in 17th century Aleppo, where we have no clue about the current whereabouts of their acquisitions? And I would just also like kind of try to throw in a broadening of the question there, which is, are there untold stories even of, manuscript collectors whom we can't trace at all?
Yes, That's a very good question. I mean, it was probably clear, well, it'll be clear to anybody who's read the book, but it will probably be clear from the slides as well that the two most important collectors I'm talking about, Pocock and Huntington, to some extent, it was possible to do that because their collections are still preserved as entire collections in the Bodleian Library. But yes, in answer to the question, there were and are some chaplains who collected whose books I was not able to find. One of them is Robert Frampton. Robert Frampton is, in many ways, he's a central figure in the book, but most of what I say about him is based on a rather mysterious biography, which was written by an unknown author, and in which the author says that Frampton did put together quite a large collection of manuscripts, but unfortunately, despite my searches, I wasn't able to find out what happened to them. So he could, that something could turn up which would illuminate Robert Frampton's books at some point. And there were others as well, actually. You mentioned Marina, John Gies. John Gies was a fairly minor figure, but he was the brother of an Oriental scholar in England called William Gies. And it's certain from some aside comments in letters that he also collected manuscripts, but I wasn't able to find out what happened to his, unfortunately, either.
Thank you for that. So now a very different type of question, drilling into this kind of, you know, microhistory of material culture and the infrastructure without which we can't actually understand how any of this worked. This is from Ahmed El-Mamouri, who asks, what are the most important transportation methods and the most important types of ships used for the purposes of transport and trade between Britain, Turkey, and the Middle East in this period? He's the director of the Basra Museum.
Right. Okay. Well, that's I have to admit I couldn't. I haven't got the technical know-how to describe the exact types of ships which were used. Maybe perhaps what I could say, as far as it relates to manuscripts, is I was very interested in trying to work out from the Levant Company records the kind of the schedule, if you like, of shipping, and it was. Therefore possible to think about the way that that people would have been able to convey manuscripts back to England. And I suppose what really came to the fore of that was the extraordinary difficulty that that this would have occasioned and how much kind of practical planning would have had to go into doing that. So yeah, sorry, that's probably not a very good answer to the question.
But, shipping schedules are actually very interesting. I mean, you also have some caravan information, right? Caravan schedules are another big deal for the transport of these manuscripts. So yes, you did deal with that. That was impressive, by the way, right now, how you just switched into German. So I'm glad that happened. So now a question from Haig Smith. The chaplains seem to have been encouraged to develop relationships with local merchants, brokers, and intellectuals by the Levant Company. And the question is, did those relationships have a purpose or an intent beyond the exchange of knowledge? Was there a kind of awareness that the relationship served to benefit the commercial aspirations of the company, you know, in the way that sort of like, you know, cultural attachés are doing a kind of soft diplomacy? I think that might have been part of the intent of this question.
Yeah, it's one of the things I really tried to think hard about when I was writing the book. And I think in general, I would probably say no, that most of the things that I'm interested in, i.e. manuscript collecting, these kind of antiquarian expeditions, didn't really seem to do anything to benefit the company. That said, I think it's probably important to say that the company directors certainly didn't object to chaplains doing this kind of thing. One of the sources I used to do this was to go very carefully through the records of the meetings. So the general court of the Levant Company met weekly and recorded in some detail their meetings, and I was able to read through those and to look at the moments where they appointed chaplains and try to work out what their what their agenda was and what they were trying to achieve. And there were various points where they would say things along the lines of, it would be a great benefit to our nation to appoint such a learned man as Dr. So-and-so to be chaplain in uh, in Aleppo, but they didn't. But that didn't really seem to acquaint to the idea of there being cultural attaches or in any sense. I think it was more a sense that learning and holiness and a good moral life would come together. So the two things are quite different, really, I think.
So we've exhausted the questions in the Q&A, but I did want to ask you one final question as we move towards wrapping things up here, and that is, what are you working on now? What's your next project going to be?
Ah, good question. Well, I'm very interested in. I'm currently in Halle, as I think Carousel is in Germany, but I'm in Halle, and I'm currently working on a number of things. One of them about a fairly minor German scholar and an organizer of Protestant missions in the 18th century called Johann Heinrich Kallenberg. So that's one project. Another project is I'm very interested in a Syrian Christian known to the most of the people he met as Carolus Rali Dadihi, who was also in Halle. And so his story and his adventures are something which I'm hoping to finish at some point soon.
Well, we'll look hugely forward to reading your subsequent work. And it's been absolutely great hearing you talk about this book. And I'll hand it back to Carol now.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Marina. Thank you, Simon, very much for that fascinating insight into different world of the 17th, 18th century and trade in manuscripts and what it sort of said about relations between the UK and the region at that time. It's a very different world to the 19th century one, and a fascinating, again, insight. And it's great actually to catch up with you sort of 10 years later on behalf of CBRL and sort of see where it all went and hear you speak. I was just saying when we were connecting, I was actually reminded that I knew you were going to publish a book sometime about now, and I was looking at the history of the Department of Antiquities, and I found that a past director general from the 1950s who worked with Kathleen Kenyon had written his thesis, one of the first theses at SOAS, on the traders of Aleppo, and it made me think, I wonder where Simon is. And so here we are today. So that's so it's really good to connect with you and see you doing so well and hearing about your new projects, and also fantastic to have Marina Rusto with us today, sort of bringing a different insight into sort of the world of CBRL webinars, and a very different kind of Levant to today. So thank you very much indeed for accepting the invitation to chair. So I'd also like to thank everybody who's joined us today for this CBRL webinar. We hope you enjoyed the event. And please do look at our website for future events. The next event in this series is going to be on the 18th of November, another Wednesday at 5 p.m. rather than our usual 4 p.m. by Dr. Gerasimos Sorapas, who's senior lecturer in Middle East politics at the University of Birmingham, who's going to be talking about a very contemporary subject of migration diplomacy in the Levant, lessons from the Syrian refugee crisis. So please, if you can, join us then. And if you'd like to hear more, we do everything from very contemporary issues to archaeological to historical issues. Please consider signing up for our email list, following us on Twitter or Facebook or LinkedIn. And even we're also a membership society, so even becoming a member, this would all be very much appreciated. And thank you all for your interest in the Levant and for joining us today. So goodbye. from Amman and from wherever you are.